Hi, and welcome to Boss Talk. My name is Philip Bish. I'm an analyst at Intelligent Investor, and I have with me today Sebastian Evans, CEO of NAOS Asset Management. Welcome, Sebastian.
Great to be here.
For those who aren't aware of NAOS Asset Management, tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, no, not too many people know about us. So we run two listed investment companies. So our first one is, the code is NCC. It's the NAOS Emerging Opportunities Company. And it focuses on small cap and micro cap stocks specifically in a concentrated format. So we only own about 10 positions. Our second LIC is NAC, and that focuses on a slightly larger market cap than NCC. So it's more that mid cap focus. So anywhere between the top 100 and 300.
Your portfolios have performed very well over the last 12 months and 4 years. So what do you think are the key things that have enabled this performance?
So ultimately, we believe in having a concentrated portfolio. So we only have 10 to 15 investments. And we're big believers this helps us perform because A, we know our investments hopefully better than a lot of our competitors. But ultimately, it allows us to hopefully not have many stocks that obviously lag the index or lose capital over time. So I think many people are led to believe that diversification equals better risk-adjusted returns, but I think if you look at the numbers, ultimately what it leads to is more mediocre performance because you own more mediocre stocks because you're forced to own more stocks. So our portfolio has 10 to 15 investments, and we've been, through our investment process, been able to outperform the index significantly because a lot of those investments are very company-specific and they've had their own, I suppose, specific results, announcements, developments that's been able to drive their share price much higher than the rest of the market over the last 4 years.
Okay, so tell us about some of your bigger holdings and how those companies are travelling at the moment. I know you've got BSA Limited and Armadale. Tell us about those.
So interesting time because I'll all report in, well, this month in February. So BSA's had a great run. They're a contracting business, but really over time migrated towards the NBN. So they do a lot of NBN installs. They've won one of the contracts for that. They also won one of the maintenance contracts for NBN. So when NBN's eventually up and running, they'll do a lot of the maintenance work for that network. Great exposure because ultimately NBN's a very large project. It's only really with three key contractors being ServiceStream, Telstra and BSA. So the ability for them to grow revenue over time has been significant and hopefully margins as well. Armadale Investments, which is the other one you mentioned, it was a leasing business. They still have an equipment leasing business or in that SME space. And they've, over the last 12 months, they've developed into more the equipment finance broking side of things. So the best example I can give anyone is Steadfast Insurance, which is the insurance broker. Insurance broking, they've consolidated that space. And then over time, they may underwrite some of those insurance policies as well. Armadale are looking to find the leases through the broking business. They'll clip a ticket, and then over time they'll fund some of those leases through their own leasing book. So they almost have the vertically integrated, and they'll consolidate a market that's very fragmented, like what mortgage broking was 25 years ago.
Okay, so do you believe both of those companies have got plenty of growth ahead of them?
Yeah, so I'm a big believer overall that just because something's had a good run doesn't mean you should sell it. You tend to find that your best performers tend to be your best performers for a very long time. And I think if you look in the case of BSA, yes, they've performed very well, but they haven't really touched the sides when it's come to their margin uplift, in my view. I mean, they've got some ambitions to grow the margin. They haven't done that yet. And when you look at NBN, NBN doesn't ramp up really until next year and the year after. And then the same with Armadale. I mean, it's a $40 billion market in broking, and they're only $2 billion of that market, yet they're the largest player. So there's plenty of room to consolidate, albeit stocks aren't as cheap as what they were 2 years ago.
We're now hitting reporting season. We've seen a number of small caps issue downgrades. Mm-hmm. One of those is Certex. Now, I know you held Certex. So, I mean, do you still hold them now? What's your view on the company now?
Yeah, so no, good. It's one we've been in and out of now for 4 years. And to be fair, we've actually traded it very well until this time, unfortunately. But in saying that, we've been buying more shares recently. The reason why is, I think fundamentally, Certex is a very good business, has great margins, has been able to grow its revenue stream pretty steadily over the last, I think you go back 10 years. The issues that came from the downgrade were, unfortunately, they've been investing ahead of some trial results that are coming up, and what you've seen was the revenue growth hasn't been as strong as what they would expect because there's some competition issues, but yet they're hiring more salespeople, more marketing people, spending more on research and development. In our view, we probably didn't think that that's sustainable. I think to invest ahead of the curve that aggressively is not the right thing for shareholders. So we would expect, you know, if you can reduce that expense line a little bit yet maintain the revenue line, we believe that Certex is undervalued and the ability for them to grow earnings again should come through over the next two or three years. And I think with a new MD, after the MD resigned a couple of months ago, we would expect that to occur over the next 6 months.
Okay, fantastic. Now, just in regards to sectors, what sectors are you looking at the moment? I know in your second quarter presentation, you mentioned agriculture, you know, resources kind of mentioned as well. What do you think is the, you know, the best sectors to look at going forward?
So we always say we're sector agnostic. So we're not, unfortunately, we're stock pickers. I think you pick sectors, it makes it very hard because you're ultimately probably predicting more macro calls. You're looking at the macro environment. But in saying that, we don't invest in resources. The reason for that is, I think ultimately it's a leverage play to a commodity price. Commodity prices are a function of a macroeconomic view, I suppose, which we don't have any, I suppose, insight into. But in saying that, if you look at Australia and you look at some of the sectors that we feel are interesting of late, we mentioned agriculture. So a stock that we've been looking at is Webster's. They're the largest water right owner in Australia now, surprisingly. There are a number of other agricultural companies out there. And I think, you know, many years ago, the agriculture space in Australia was on the nose. But I think companies have come a long way now in regards to their disclosure, having actual cash flow, not just being an NTA play. But ultimately, I think the way we invest will always be focused on industrials. That's really our bread and butter. And that's probably been one of the softest parts of the market over the past 12 months.
So is that where you see the opportunities at the moment?
Yeah, without a doubt. I think, you know, the industrial space is tough. I think in reporting season, I know the market's rallied hard, but a lot of that's been because of higher resource prices or commodity prices and higher resource share prices. But ultimately, we'll be looking at the industrial space. There's been lots of downgrades, and ultimately stocks get sold off, you know, very aggressively and potentially into values where they represent, for us, good long-term value. I think there's, you know, a lot of people look for higher quality stocks or, you know, lower quality stocks, but ultimately what you're looking for as an investor is an undervalued stock, and that's what we're looking for in the industrial space.
When I was reading through your monthly reports, it was quite noticeable that you do a lot of company visits. Mm-hmm. So how many company visits do you roughly do every month, and what sort of things are you trying to, you know, glean from those visits?
So I think, you know, on average we try to, I think the view was we get close to 400 to 500 a year. But that would be, you know, without a doubt, there's duplication in there. You're going to see your largest investments. You know, we'd be in touch with our largest investments at least once a month or once every 2 weeks. And ultimately, what you're trying to get from, I think, if you're just with the company and management, you're looking for consistency. So, you know, a clear strategy, alignment, consistency, the ability to deliver on those goals or strategic targets. That's the most important thing in small caps and mid caps. No deviation from some set strategy. You know, random acquisitions, sort of things that seem very out of nowhere or come out of, you know, the things you just wouldn't expect. But ultimately what you need to do when you're talking to a lot of management teams is you need to double check it. So you'll talk to a lot of their industry competitors, unlisted competitors, channel checks, so some of their customers to get a feel on, yes, management's telling me this. Ultimately though, they're aligned and they've probably got a little bit of a conflict of interest. So you need to double check that with as many sources as you can.
Okay, and just a question, what's your view on markets, you know, maybe globally and locally going forward? I know we've got the Trump factors and all that sort of stuff playing into it.
Yeah, so
where do you think that's all going?
Been pretty topical, I suppose, over the past 3 months. And, you know, big disclaimer is we don't pick markets, but if you're asking me for my own view is, you know, I think markets will remain volatile. I think everyone talks about the Trump effect and it's bullish, and over time you'll cut corporate tax rates and earnings will rise. I think against a backdrop for me, I think you have, you know, rising interest rates, which I think initially is quite positive, but I think as they get higher, it starts to become quite detrimental. I think you then have inflation, which can become quite detrimental as well. And then I think the big risk for me is obviously China and their ability to, you know, it was the forefront of our mind 12 months ago, but, you know, today everyone seems to forget about it. You know, I think they've got issues in regards to capital outflows, inflation, their own country-specific issues, which can have, you know, we're still very much tied to China, and that could have a significant issue on our own domestic economy, which in my view remains relatively fragile. I mean, we're very reliant on a residential housing boom. You know, if that falls over, we need an infrastructure boom, or, you know, tourism to pick up. You know, the dollar's creeping up again, which is not great for Australia. It'll be interesting to see it plays out. But I think, you know, if you look at the last 5 years, in my view, I think we're just going to get more of the same. And that's a market that tracks sideways. It's a stock picker's market. It, you know, for me, it remains the same for another 1, 2, 3 years. So I'm not a bull, I'm not a bear. But I just think you stick to your basics and what you know best.
Thank you, Sebastian. So how do you like to communicate with your investors? I know that's important to the company.
No, it is. Ultimately, our shareholders dictate where our share price is, and it's there's no point performing without a higher share price if no one buys your shares. So we've tried to make a big effort. We do a monthly report. We do a quarterly conference call where people can ask myself and the investment team questions. We've also started a roadshow twice a year, which will now be held in the 5 capital cities around Australia, and it starts on the 28th of February, which anyone's invited to. They can bring friends along, and they can simply just register on our website, which is naos.com.au.
Thank you for your time today.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you, viewers. Bye.